Good to see each one. Okay. If you will, take your hymnals and turn to 366 as we begin. 366. Heaven Came Down. This is a great song of testimony. Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows dispelling with joy, I am telling, He made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down in glory, filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down in glory, filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love. Oh, what a standing is mine! And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came. Took of the offer of grace He did proffer, He saved me, oh praise His dear name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day, when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
Good morning, everybody. So good to see you today and some of the visitors that we have us with today. I'm going to mention about the announcements. Let's see. We're going to be having a meeting tonight, a little bit for teachers, people who can be involved in BBS, anybody working with children. We're going to talk a little bit about safety working with the children, and we want to make sure that they're well protected. And next Sunday, we're going to have a little short meeting for the VBS workers. So anybody that's involved in VBS, we're gonna have a little talk about that next week. And next week, because of preparation for VBS, we're not gonna be having a Sunday night service next week. But I wanna remind you, Vacation Bible School begins on Monday the 13th, 6 p.m., going through Friday. So either you have children or grandchildren or neighbors or whatnot, you can bring them for VBS. They'll have a wonderful time. There's wonderful little stories and things put out together and crafts. They will really enjoy that. We do want to congratulate. It looks like there's three anniversaries this week. The Melicks, the Tarpleys, and the Chisholms. We want to congratulate them on their anniversary this week. Let's go ahead and open in prayer. Dear Lord, I ask you that you'll guide with the service today. I ask you that you'll please be with us and help us with the things that we do this week, with the speaker, and all that happens this day. In your name. We're going to go ahead and read the passage this is NLT. We'll just go ahead and read it from the screen. When we get to the last slide, this is a little different. Let's read it together in unison, if we can. I know it's a little different than we normally do, but let's read it together in unison. The last one should be verses 10 and 11. Okay, and now a word to you who are elders in the churches. I too am an elder and a witness to the sufferings of Christ, and I too will share in his glory when he is revealed to the whole world. As a fellow elder, I appeal to you. Care for the flock that God has entrusted to you. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you will get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. Don't lord it over the people assigned to your care, but lead them by your own good example. And when the great shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of never-ending glory and honor. In the same way, you who are younger must accept the authority of the elders, and all of you, dress yourselves in humility as you relate to one another, for God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves under the mighty power of God, and at the right time he will lift you up in honor. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering you are. And together, in his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you. He will place you on a firm foundation, all power to him forever. Amen.
Also, just kind of an additional church family announcement. Today is a special day for Stephen, my son, as he is finally to that point of being commissioned. He's been in the Army, as many of you know, and already done some interesting things there, including having gone to Afghanistan twice. But he's been working through college, he's got his degree, he's gone through this long process of qualifying for med school and getting in a type of a scholarship program that will allow him to basically be trained to be an Army doctor for a while. So he'll be doing it on their dime, and there's a lot involved there for qualifying and getting that done. But as a part of that, he becomes a doctor, and so he's going from being a staff sergeant to being a second lieutenant this morning. And so that commissioning service is occurring with his unit while it's down in Fort Jackson in Columbia. And then also you'll notice that Dan and Ava are not here this morning. As Dan, many of you may realize, and some of you may not, Dan had a rather distinguished career in the Army as a Fulbert colonel, and he is involved with commissioning him with that. So that's a special time for them and something all of us can rejoice in, since we've been praying and supporting for Stephen as he has gradually worked through his degree for this important step. They have found a house also. That's a big praise. It hasn't closed yet, but it looks like everything should go well with that. So I just wanted to update you in that regard. Number 409 next, please. 409, As the Deer. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone Spirit heal. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. Our voices when we get to the refrain this next time. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone, my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and to worship you. Amen. Thanks.
Men, come forward for the offering, please. John, can you pray, please?
Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, I praise you and I thank you for who you are and all that you do in our lives. As you have promised, you have met our needs. And I pray that as we give back a gift to you, that you would give this body here the wisdom to know how to use it. And I pray it might bring glory to you. In honor to your holy name, I pray in Christ's name with thanksgiving. Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joy. Great is thy faithfulness. Another song of testimony that ties in well with the other songs that we are singing today. Now, before Pastor comes with the message number 134, 134 all the way. And let me invite you, please, to stand as we sing. Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Community Bible Church here in Holly Springs. It's good to have you with us today. Good to have some visitors with us. Thank you for coming. And if you want to take your Bibles and find the book of Acts chapter 20, that's where we'll be this morning. And then let me just mention a few things. We have 26 registered already, Mindy, for VBS. So that is a very good number. And we will get, Lord willing, prayerfully, we will get a good number that come to register on the opening night next Monday night. But for now, online registration, we have 26, and so that's already a great number. So we're thankful for that. Don't forget about the meeting next Sunday. And then also, we will need to clear out every chair in here, the pulpit, and rearrange some things next Sunday after the morning service. So if you're able to maybe stick around with us for another, I know there's a meeting after for the VBS workers, but at the conclusion of that, we'll try to clear out and then set up for VBS. So if you could, if you're interested in helping, stick around for maybe, wouldn't take more than 20 or 30 minutes, I think. But whatever you're able to give, that would be great. We appreciate that as we set up for VBS. And let me see, lots more. But let me just, let's come to the text this morning. Let me read the text. I'll make a few comments after prayer, rather than then we will begin together. I'm in Acts chapter 20, so take your Bibles and find Acts 20. Can't find it, so I'm going to give up. All right, we will proceed otherwise. Acts chapter 20, let me begin reading in verse number 28. We'll read through verse number 32. Acts chapter 28, actually I do have this, I believe. Yes, I do. All right, so I'm reading out of the English Standard Version, the ESV, so if you'd like to follow along, I actually have the text on the screen this morning. Acts chapter 20, verse 28. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Therefore be alert, remembering that for 3 years I did not cease, night or day, to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified. Let's begin with a word of prayer this morning. Our Father, thank you again for the privilege that we have to come together. And thank you for the freedom that we enjoy to be able to gather around and to fellowship around the Word of God, to fellowship with the family of God, with other brothers and sisters in Christ, and to have the opportunity to sing and to make much of you today. I pray that through the Word this morning, we give you thanks for it. We thank you for the truths found in it. We pray that they would be helpful today as leadership, as elders, consider the text before us, and as we all examine the reality of our part in helping in this matter this morning. So I pray that you would guide our time together and direct, speak to us through your Spirit. I pray for clarity. I pray for help this morning with the subject matter. I pray that in all things you would be glorified and honored as we continue this discussion through the evening and throughout perhaps the weeks to come, that we would be helped because of it. And so we thank you for the privilege this morning when we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Let me borrow an analogy from Bill Baddorf that has helped me tremendously over the years. He used to say, if there's a nail sticking up, you just stop and drive it in. And what he meant by that was if you're, whatever you're doing, laying carpet, washing windows, whatever your primary task was to do, be at that, do it all for the glory of God. That's the way Bill described these things. But if you come to something that you see is so obvious and it needs help, then just set aside for a moment, deal with it, and then return to your primary work. Well, I use that analogy because that's exactly what we're going to do this morning. Not to minimize the importance of the subject that we're dealing with, but typically, and actually, we are in a study of the book of Philippians. Now, we've been in it a number of weeks. We've not even gotten out of the first chapter. We're coming close, though. But over the next several months, we will continue to study the book of Philippians. But for today, we're going to set that aside, and we're going to drive a nail. We're going to take care of something that is important to us. Well, what's the subject matter? Well, it's no surprise, and it's not new. And we're going to be dealing today with multiple aspects of this truth. And this morning, I choose to look at it from the God-given responsibility that the elders and leadership of the church have. It is a fearful thing to read a number of passages of Scripture that deal with the elders in the church. We're not professionals. This is not a job that you can take and leave at 9 and 5 and just deal with. There's tremendous spiritual battle and warfare when we consider the church and those who are against the church. We are not perfect. We are not dealing with perfect people. And as we remember that, it makes for some sticky situations, does it not? And I think this last month, May, really brought this to a head. We are all familiar that humanity is depraved. The best of men are only men at their best. People hide behind a persona. They hide behind reputation. Men can hide very well and do some of the most unspeakable evil acts, not only behind the closed door in their personal lives. We think of the Larry Nassar, the U.S. Olympics gymnast team, and the Penn State coach, Sandusky, I believe, was his name. We're aware of that, but we are at a point today, and this has been made, brought to light over the last month, that you can be one of the most well-known pastors, leaders, evangelists, apologists in the country, in the world, and be hiding all kinds of devious behavior behind the scenes. Last month, PCA, Presbyterian Church of America, released an independent, independent report, 220 pages documenting abuse, how it was handled, how it was covered up, how it was perpetrated, all of the details in a 220-page letter. We are familiar with also the guidepost report of the Southern Baptist Convention just this last month, a 280-page report documenting cases of abuse where pastors and leaders have a number of accusations founded with evidence, and there are even expressions of guilt in some of these cases, but they were merely shifted to another state to take over a pastorate there or a work or a ministry. It is these kind of sins that disqualify a man from holding that kind of position. Can he ever be reinstated? Well, that's a question that is very complex. It's not what we're going to address today. But I would say no, not today, not tomorrow, not this month, not this year. The Church of God, when we stand as leaders of those who are to give their trust to us and to have their confidence in us, when we betray that, that has crossed a big line. That has gone beyond a mistake, a slip-up, an accident. I think it's Bob Jones Sr. that said, behind every great moral failure, there's a slow, steady process of wicked and evil thinking. But these individuals are not the victims. They made a choice. Even in cases, which is rare with what we're going to talk about, that a person who legally may not be able to consent, or even an adult who has consent, even if they give it everything they have in matters of seduction and to try to trip a person up, that man is supposed to be so godly and so spirit-filled and such an example for others to follow that he would say no. And yet we find that not only is our world overrun with this kind of corruption and evil, many churches are full of it. And it's really sad to think through, and a number of studies, I've not come to this, and but recently these things have brought it up to my attention. But even back in the 90s, I believe it was ABC did a documentary, Praying from the Pulpit, P-R-E-Y-I-N-G. This is 30 years ago plus, documenting this kind of behavior. One particular church that was just wicked with all of this child abuse and sexual immorality among leaders, among youth pastors, among bus captains and deacons. It was traced that out of that church, seven other churches had experienced similar things. This is an issue. And so we're going to deal with it today and tonight, because in a few weeks we are going to be taking, Lord willing, at least 26 children into this church property with the confidence that we can handle them, that we will handle them, and that there will be none of this evil going on. So we need to talk about some things. In Acts chapter 20, Paul calls the Ephesus elders, the Ephesian church there, the elders together, because he wants to bear his heart. And boy, does he ever. There's a number of passages of Scripture that we could go to from the Apostle Paul to model elder and leadership behavior. But as I, the last couple weeks, in all the heaviness of considering this topic of reading through reports and considering really a topic that has spanned the entirety of my adult life, as far back as I can remember, relocation, shaming, silencing, blaming the victim, all of these things were being done in the name of protecting the ministry. You'll ruin this ministry. You'll bring everything to the ground. And so unless you keep quiet, we will ruin you. In all that heaviness, it was refreshing to consider multiple passages, but I settled on Acts chapter 20 because Paul really does. He just, he leaves nothing out. He addresses them with a heart of compassion, with the care that every elder and that every leader in the church of God would just aspire to and want to have. So let's look at this passage together. We read verse 28 through 32, and I want us to give us four words that will help us. The first word is truth. Truth. Paul loved Christ, and therefore Paul loved the church. And Paul was committed to sharing the truth. And those who love God and those who love God's people ought to be about the truth. We ought to be truth tellers. We ought to be truth seekers. We ought to be those who promote the truth. The truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, yes. And that's what Paul deals with quite a bit here in this passage. But it goes beyond that. Truth in any realm. We're not afraid of truth. We ought not to be afraid of truth. We ought to strive for the truth in this matter. One of the things that keeps coming up and continues to be a source to perpetuate this kind of evil, of abuse in the church, is the idea of loyalty rather than truth. I remember a number of years ago, about 20 years ago, when I was on a journey in my own life and studying things, and there was so many questions, and I followed trails of connections and events that happened all the way back 40-some years now ago, where a pastor was accused of tremendous wrongdoing, tremendous accusations. By his own statement in his deposition, half of them he clearly expressed to doing. And yet what came out of that were buttons that were 100% buttons showing full support. What came out of it was the dismissal of deacons who stood against him and wanted answers rather than to demand loyalty. The baseline was that God only asks us to trust Him. And so I am asking the same of you. Accusations can be false, but we must not view anyone who comes forth as a threat to be neutralized rather than a voice to be heard. If there is no truth to it, then what are we afraid of? Is our God not big enough to lay the evidence out there in our favor? We can trust Him, but when it comes to eldership, leadership positions, we cannot hide behind the loyalty aspect. We must demand answers. We want to do due diligence in finding out whether these things are so. And so we seek truth. Number two, and that is value. Every elder ought to recognize the value of that which he has been entrusted to. Whenever you go to the passages that deal with leadership in the church and eldership in the church, there's always the idea of being entrusted. Someone else who owns the property or owns this valuable has entrusted it to our care. You know, we demonstrate the weight and the value that we put on items by the way we care for them, by the way we treat them. I don't leave valuables just laying around in the backyard. They're protected. They're locked up. They're cared for. I don't throw them around. That which is very expensive, that which is very valuable, that which would take a tremendous amount of money and work to replace is not treated lightly. The church of God, there is a price. We're told about that here, purchased with the blood of our Savior. And we've been entrusted to it. And so there's the idea of value. Notice verse 28. Here's the command: pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which He obtained with His own blood. There's a lot of things here. We find our purpose. We are under shepherds. We are over the people that God's entrusted to us, but we are ultimately underneath the great shepherd, Jesus Christ, who is the head, the founder of the church. We do not seek our own kingdom. We seek the kingdom of God. We seek for His church. And notice the value placed here. First of all, on yourselves, you cannot lead properly if you've not first taken care of yourselves. That's why there are qualifications and specific ones given, of which fidelity, integrity in matters of sexual purity and in marriage are one of. It's not the only one. It has more to do with just being divorced. It has to be the idea of having the only woman that you desire and seek to satisfy your love and expressions of commitment together is your wife. Any other behavior is grounds for disqualification. One year ago, I dealt with the matter of deconversion. You may remember that, in which I mentioned a specific individual who was fed up with church because of this kind of behavior, because of the activities that go on behind closed doors. These men who not only confess to elements of wrongdoing are merely excused, shipped to the other side of the country, and placed in a ministry there. Pay careful attention to yourselves, notice, and to all the flock. When we talk about abuse, it's not just sexual abuse, and it's not just minors. It's not just underage. There are 6, 7, or 8 levels of abuse, depending on which study you want to read. But there's physical abuse, verbal abuse, emotional abuse, spiritual abuse, financial abuse, economic abuse, and sexual abuse. And while we perhaps today are limiting our consideration to our children's ministry and what goes on with the youth that God has entrusted to us here, it's been quite a week. It's been quite a couple of weeks considering all of these things. And I don't want you to think that our focus today is a limitation. I'm not placing a limitation on it. I've realized that on my desk are a number of books regarding spousal abuse and spiritual abuse, emotional abuse, all ranges of abuse that are not only going on in the world around us, but many times they're going on in the churches around us. And so we need to be careful. Pay attention to yourselves and to all the flock. Notice that all the flock, the nursery is full of the flock. The classrooms, the kids that all left us here a few moments ago to go practice and to have their class, they're part of the flock. We cannot neglect them. We cannot overlook them. And so that's our word, to value them, to honor them, to cherish them. Let me give you a word here. Let's just go to Psalm 82. The judges, those who've been given leadership positions by God, were not fulfilling God's requirements. Here he expresses error on their part in verse 3 of Psalm 82. Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. Rescue the weak and needy. Deliver them from the hand of the wicked. If you go back and you read the whole context of Psalm 82, you'll find they were doing the opposite. So the people that God had given a position of leadership were failing to practice and exercise the compassion and the love and the care that God would give to these people. So there's value there. I want you to notice, thirdly there, verse 29, it's the word action. Every elder, every leader. And by the way, let me just stop it. Rather than you directing all of this at a few individuals who are here in this room and around the property considered elders or leadership, one of the reasons I ask that all those involved in our children's ministry be here today and especially in tonight's service is because by extension, we have authorized you in a role of leadership. Now, your name may be not on the bulletin as an elder or as a deacon, and there may not be some other ministry that you're recognized as, but you have a part in this as well. So action is the word. Notice verse 29. I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them. Big difference between those who are wolves in sheep's clothing and those who are God-given elders and leaders, and those who faithfully walk in the Spirit, allow God's power to indwell us and to live lives of victory. Well, the difference is that they twist the Scriptures, they manipulate people, they try to get a following after themselves. They're not interested in building God's kingdom. It's all about their kingdom. That's why you have this kind of mentality, don't ruin the ministry. Well, sir, you've already ruined the ministry when you couldn't keep your hands to yourself. See, that's the bottom line. Paul's a man of action. Paul here certainly would have prayed for these people. He would have warned them. He would oppose them. He would remove them. He would seek to protect them. Notice 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 14 and 15. Here's how Paul addressed situations. Alexander the coppersmith did me great harm. The Lord will repay him according to his deeds. He was not afraid to mention him by name and to tell what he had done. And then verse 15 of giving a warning, beware of him yourself, for he strongly opposed our message. Here's a passage I want you to see, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 9 through 13. An individual in the church in a relationship with a woman, not his wife. I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Not at all meaning the sexually immoral of this world, or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters, since then you would need to go out of the world. Paul is specifically focusing on not those who are evildoers in the world. We expect that from them. They're unbelievers. They're heathen. They're unregenerate. They don't know God. Here's the issue. Verse 11, but now I'm writing to you not to associate with anyone who bears the name of brother if he is guilty of sexual immorality or greed or is an idolater, reviler, drunkard, or swindler, not even to eat with such a one. For what have I to do with judging outsiders? Is it not those inside the church whom you are to judge? God judges those outside. Purge the evil person from among you. Purge them. Get rid of them. They, like leaven, he says earlier in that chapter, will influence and will corrupt. Paul was a man of action. Not only did he warn these people, but he withstood individuals who were contrary to the gospel of God and to godly living. Accountability must be. I read an article, it was just enlightening this week. The primary reason for all of this is a lack of accountability. Even though there's a board of directors, many times these board of directors are on a chart over the leadership. But in reality, they have no power. They can be refused, they can be ignored, and then they'll ultimately be gotten rid of if they make too much of a fuss in these situations. That's why I think there's a strong case for eldership. Plurality of elders. That's why when you find in the Scripture, you'll find elders addressed. Beware of one man shows where he can do as he pleases. I say that there should be action because in many of these cases, as we read the report, disqualification is step number one. We don't have to think about this very long. At this time, you have demonstrated that you are not an example for other people to follow, and so there's disqualification. They ought to be removed from their position. We ought to let others know. It is a shame to send a man across the country to serve in another ministry without honestly relaying certain instances. Prosecution is another action. South Carolina does have a mandatory reporting law for elders and for leadership who are aware of this. I read a sad report one week ago or more, of an individual in the Presbyterian Church who had been abused and thought that she had confided in the leadership at the time to submit a police report. And numerous times there were crimes, violations, and so another report was supposedly represented and turned over to authorities. A number of years later, when the story was beginning to break and a lot of other accusations were being made and she wanted to revisit, she went to the law enforcement agency only to discover there was not one report filed on her, which allowed her younger sisters to grow up in the same abusive relationship. This is not fitting the church of God. And so it needs to be called out, it needs to be warned against, and we need to make sure that it does not happen here. Final word is the word outlook. Look at verse 32. Verse 31, Paul says, "Therefore be alert." Here's another warning. "Remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. And now I commend you to God." Notice verse 32. "And now I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you the inheritance among all those who are sanctified." Paul declares in this letter, we find about it here as Luke records for us the book of Acts, that in this conversation that Paul had, he shared with them, "This is the last time I'll speak with you." And so there would be no more work, nothing more that Paul could do. So what does he do? He commends them to God. And we know Paul well enough in all of the scriptures to know that he began relationships with people in the gospel of Jesus Christ by commending them to God, that God was their Father, that God was the Savior, that all things were of God, that he would continue to work in their lives. He began the relationship that way, and he ends here with these men by commending them to God. But in the middle, there was a tremendous amount of action, so that Paul did everything he could to try to protect the church of God. For us, it means several things. It means that in churches that have not been part of the problem, it does mean that we must be prepared to be part of the solution. That's done in several ways, by keeping it out and by caring for the flock who've been in these other pastures and have been abused. Now, that's a mouthful. And I say that for the rest of my ministry, however long that might be, if it expands 30, 40 years, I know that I'll never see the end of that work. Everywhere I turn, there are people who have been abused in the one place they should have felt the safest, and that's the church of God. What's our response? Number one, to provide an environment where the study of the Word of God and the fellowship of believers can be promoted, exalted, and encouraged. We do not want people to say, "Oh, that church, you know the one over there. Do you hear what happened there?" We don't want to do that. We want to have a place here where visitors moving into our area and guests coming to visit will not have any reason like this to avoid us. We need to protect at all costs all of God's flock, from the oldest to the youngest. We need to keep them from evil men and women, and we need to keep them from the evil actions that are around them. Number three, what's our goal? Our goal is to pursue healing and care for everyone who is a survivor, everyone who has been a victim of this kind of abuse, many other kinds of abuse. And so with that, I have said a mouthful. So what are we going to do? We'll talk about it tonight. Be here. Father, thank you again for your word. I pray that as we address this heavy topic, that you would give us reassurance that the gates of hell cannot nor will not prevail against the church. The church is priceless, purchased by the sacrifice of your Son, our Savior. The church is our haven. The church is the place where, as this world becomes more and more wicked and evil, the church is a place where we can come and gather in fellowship and have confidence in one another and in you. And so I pray that you would help us to protect that. I pray that you'd give us wisdom in how we seek to do it. I pray that you would give humility as we try to implement practices and policies on top of those we already have. I pray that there would be unity in seeking to protect what you've entrusted to us, so that we may continue to give the gospel, to be a place where the Bible and the Word can be exalted, where we can make much of Jesus Christ and promote Him, building your kingdom until the day that you return. And so we ask for your help now in the days and weeks and months and years ahead, for we ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Number 255, please, as we close. 255, Fairest Lord Jesus. We'll just sing the first and the last. And please stand with me as we sing. Fairest Lord Jesus, ruler of all nature, for your attendance this morning. Have a wonderful afternoon.